Hello again, this is Mike, and I am a sports history collector. It's been about a month since my last video, and I wanted to wait like some other channels have been doing until people have had a chance to watch all of the national videos. There's always, this time of year, there's always a lot of those, and some of the other videos kind of tend to get lost amongst them. But today's going to be kind of a fun one, because it's not every day a journeyman type player gets in the record books and even mentioned in the Hall of Fame, not for being a Hall of Fame player, but for a feat that no one else has done. So this is going to be the story of Joel Youngblood and the time he got two hits for two different teams in one day in two different cities. And there's an additional to that as well. But I hope you enjoy this. The following are excerpts from a story by Matt Monahan on the MLB website. It was August 4th, 1982, and it started out as pretty much a typical day for Joel Youngblood. Sure, there were trade rumors swirling around with his impending free agency in 1983, but those had been there for most of the season. Besides, he was an all-star just the year before. Why would the Mets want to trade him? The thought was, do your best, roll with the punches, and go forward, Youngblood told the reporter. That's what the outfielder was thinking as he dug into the box in the third inning during a day game at Wrigley Field against the Cubs. Maybe Youngblood was going to get traded, maybe he wasn't, but he had to keep doing his job and play baseball. Working the count, he eventually got a single that dropped in between the left and center fielders. It scored two runs and gave the Mets a 3-1 lead. And then, well, things got crazy. It was kind of interesting, the trade happened right in the middle of the game, Youngblood remembers. In the bottom of the third inning, after giving his team the lead, Youngblood was pulled from the field because he was now a member of the new team, the Montreal Expos. Mets GM Frank Cashin had actually hoped to make the deal before the game started, but there was a phone circuit problem. For you youngsters, that used to happen every once in a while when there was a lot of phone traffic. I don't think that happens as much anymore. Anyway, and it couldn't be completed. Montreal, meanwhile, had a giant request for its newest acquisition. Montreal was short players for their game in Philadelphia, and they said that they really wanted me to try to get there, Youngblood said. And knowing the guy I am, I said, sure, I'll do my best. It was a rare request. Only a few players have ever played for two different teams in one day, but it was a night game in Philly, so it was possible. Youngblood would just have to hustle. It was a Saturday, so being on the road trip, you're not packed, Youngblood said. You gotta go change, take a shower, pay your incidentals, get a cab, go to the hotel, pack your stuff, pay your incidentals, go back to get a cab, and there was only one flight I could catch. It was a 6:05 p.m. flight, which would have got me to Philadelphia in time for 7:05. The game in Philly would start at 7:41, so with an hour and a half flight, the best Youngblood could hope for was an appearance in the later innings. But then, in the taxi on the way to the airport, Youngblood realized he had forgotten something pretty important, his glove. I left my glove in the facing in the stairway at Wrigley Field, Youngblood said. I made the cabbies go back for my glove. I used the same glove for 14 years. Having to go back and get his glove, Youngblood's chances of making the flight further dwindled. I was running, trying to get through security, trying to get to my flight, he said. I figured if I made it and my luggage didn't, then so be it. But Youngblood did somehow catch the flight, and his luggage made it on time. After landing at Philadelphia International Airport and hailing a cab to get to Veterans Stadium, he arrived at the ballpark at 9:30 p.m., where the game had already been inching towards the seventh inning. He slipped on his freshly created blue Expos uniform, waved hello across the field to his idol, Pete Rose, and 5 minutes later, after already playing in one major league game earlier in the day, and tirelessly catching cabs, planes, to travel 750 miles across the country, he heard manager Jim Fanning bark down the dugout stairs, "Youngblood! Get up here. You're hitting." Youngblood recalls laughing. With no real warm-ups or time to think, the new Expos player took some swings in the on-deck circle and then strolled up to the plate to face future Hall of Famer Steve Carlton. Luckily, Youngblood had faced Carlton numerous times, including a few times in the minors, so he felt fairly comfortable hitting it off him. Carlton ended up being the pitcher Youngblood faced most in his career, and he pretty much owned the four-time Cy Young Award winner. And wouldn't you know it, one of the eight hits Carlton gave up on the day ended up being Youngblood's single up the middle in the seventh inning. One man, two hits, two different teams, two separate cities, one day. Never happened before in baseball history and will likely never happen again. Yeah, it was a long year that year, Youngblood laughs. I went to the ballpark at 8 o'clock that morning and didn't leave until 12 o'clock that night. People don't realize the travel, the demands I had to meet to even make it there. Everything had to be in place. It worked out good. Statistically, the odds were against me, though. But at the time, you don't think about those things. Even though he was surprised by all the calls from the media he got the next day, telling them, hey, it was just a single. Youngblood now relishes the moment in the game's lore. I'll always be known, I guess. My name will never go away, he said from his home in Arizona. I'll always have that record. It'll be hard for someone to break it. And now for a quick tidbit. If you haven't guessed it by now from the items I have here, not only did Joel Youngblood get two hits for two different teams in two separate cities in one day, but he did it off two future Hall of Famers, Steve Carlton, and the Cubs pitcher was Fergie Jenkins. And those are not just any two Hall of Famers. Between them, they had five Cy Youngs and 13 20-win seasons. That just puts the cherry on top of what would be an unforgettable day for Joel Youngblood and baseball fans everywhere. Anyway, what I have for my collection today is Joel Youngblood's 1984 Tops, which is signed beautifully in blue Sharpie across his body from kind of bottom to top. Real nice autograph on that one. Also have two signed baseballs from the pitchers, the Hall of Fame pitchers that gave up the hits, Ferguson Jenkins and Steve Carlton. Steve Carlton, I actually had never got around to getting a ball from him, even though I had seen him at shows multiple times, got other things signed. But for some reason, never got a ball, and I rectified that earlier this year at the Burbank show in February. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed the story of Joel Youngblood and his day of travel. And I hope you enjoyed it, and we'll talk to you soon.
I was toting my pack along the dusty Winnemucca Road when along came a semi with a high-end canvas-covered load. If you're going to Winnemucca Mac with me, you can ride. And so I climbed into the cab and then I settled down inside. He asked me if I'd seen a road with so much dust and sand, and I said, listen, I've traveled every road in this here land. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts bare, man. I breathe the mountain air, man. Of travel I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere. I've been to Reno, Chicago, Fargo, Minnesota, Buffalo, Toronto, Winslow, Sarasota, Wichita, Tulsa, Ottawa, Oklahoma, Tampa, Panama, Mattawa, La Paloma, Bangor, Baltimore, Salvador, Amarillo, Tocopilla, Barranquilla, and Padilla. I'm a killer. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts, bare, man. I breathe the mountain air, man. Travel, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere. I've been to Boston, Charleston, Dayton, Louisiana, Washington, Houston, Kingston, Texas, County, Monterey, Faraday, Santa Fe, Tallapoosa, Glen Rock, Black Rock, Little Rock, Oskaloosa, Tennessee, Chicopee, Spirit Lake, Grand Lake, Devil's Lake, Crater Lake, Beach Lake. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts, bare, man. I breathe the mountain air, man. Of travel, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere. I've been to Louisville, Nashville, Knoxville, Ombabaka, Shepherdville, Jacksonville, Waterville, Coast, Rocket, Pittsfield, Springfield, Bakersfield, Shreveport, Hackensack, Cadillac, Fond du Lac, Davenport, Idaho, Jellicoe, Argentina, Diamantina, Pasadena, Catalina, Sea, Guatemala. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts, bare, man. I breathe the mountain air, man. I've traveled, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere.